common man, the little guy that gets tromped on, that has an injustice served to them. That's what this show is about. So if you're in that situation or you know anybody that is, please shoot me an email, kevin@masterofmanythings.com, and get up and talk about it. We'll work very hard to pull together resources to help you. We'll work very hard to share your information. And at the very least, we're going to help you just get it out, because a lot of times you just got to get it out. And enough about me. Our guest, Rich Fu, is with us. Rich, welcome to the show.
Good evening, and thank you for having me on. Like I said, I really appreciate it. You know, given the support that I've seen lately, it truly helps. It truly does, especially given the nature of things.
Well, Rich, the privilege is mine, really. You know, it's people like you and my guests last week that, make this show what it is. It's for the people. It's an honor to do it. I mean, there's been so many times in my life where people, and even people that I didn't know, just stood up and helped me, And this is something that is dear to me because I don't see a lot of the talk radio hosts doing this. And that doesn't mean they're doing bad things. It just means that, you know, they have their cause. And I believe we need just a regular guy, which I am. I take the line of master of many things because I do a lot of things well. But that isn't a boast. I'm not narcissistic. So anybody that's new to me, don't get it twisted. But, you know, we need somebody. Yeah, we need a guy out there doing this. Who's fighting for us? Who's doing this? So that's why I do this. And if it wasn't for people like you that break that barrier of fear, standing up and making yourselves available to come on and tell your story, which will help other people, I would be nothing. This show would be nothing. So, it's an honor to have you here tonight. And I gave everybody a brief overview, but I'd like to hand it over to you. And kind of start from the beginning. I mean, the focus really was on this abuse, neglect, torment, and otherwise by Kar Arms. But we need to know a little bit about you, obviously. And then, lead us in. Dates, times, any information you want to share with us, the floor is yours, Rich.
Basically express that, we've all had our struggles as we've grown old, the days going on, and hoping to learn from these things as we go on day by day. And I overcame a lot of adversity and beat the odds in order to become successful in a line of career that I was very happy with, extremely happy with. In 2008, on my way to work, I was hit head-on in a car accident by a lady that fell asleep on the wheel. Which caused some injuries that took me out of my line of work. 9 months later, I got hit again, which made it even extremely more difficult. And it caused injuries to where these witnesses said, I'll never be climbing a ladder again. And it's extremely uncomfortable for me to do certain things, like, sit for a period of time, especially in an uncomfortable chair. I broke a piece off my spine, and the nerves get caught in it. So he just went to say this, I worked 3 years in physical therapy. Even being able to get to a level of life where I was comfortable with, I was happy, I struggled severely. But I finally got there and I started working for Kar Arms once I got myself healthy again. With the understanding from the Institute that, I had permissions. I had twice went through the car accidents, and I'm going to work in my career again. And they were seemed understanding at first and said, what can we do to help out? Well, basically, I need two things. And with the understanding that I have doctor's appointments at least once a month. And no need to get off a chair for my back in order to remain comfortable. With that said, they still hired me. If you go look online right now, for example, carblock.com, if you look through and search my name on Rich and Kar, you'll see that I treat people with the utmost respect. I treat everybody with the utmost respect. And I have a lot of compassion for what I've grown through my life. people with empathy and compassion. That's the way I wanted to be treated. I didn't recognize this. If somebody showed me that, I didn't recognize. And I felt that everything was such. I was great to these people. I was great to the customers. They must go by. I'm sitting in a chair. I had no backrest. And, now physically it did have a piece there, like an arm for a backrest. There was no spring on the actual backrest itself, so if you went to both the back, there was nothing really there to support. They would just go all the way back. Obviously it's causing problems. So I was complaining about it. And, I just kept on telling me, hey, we'll get you one. Keep on working. I did what I had to do. I still kept the respect. I still did my job perfectly. Finally, about 5 months in, they moved the office. They tell me, hey, listen, we finally got you in the chair. I want you to go check it out. They moved all this stuff up there for me. My condition, not like it wasn't obvious. When I first started working at Smite Web and had my back nerve getting bad, I started to walk funnier and funnier. It destroyed my knee. I'm starting to live more and more. They tell me I had a new chair. I go all the way up there, go to sit down, and the chair looked brand new. So I go to sit down in it, and it delays for a second, and then it falls right down on the ground straight down. Now, I don't mean the chair collapses, I mean that the spring is in such a way where it doesn't rest, and when it's kind of grabs for a second, and then it just springs all the way down. Now, given the nature of my back and my condition, I mean, that's something that's very destructive. Very destructive. Everybody stopped laughing. I didn't think it was very funny. It didn't hurt my nerve like that. In fact, it was a bit of pain for about a week and a half, 2 weeks after I shared my cane, which I haven't had to use for a long time. Due to my doctor to heal. Basically, I crushed the nerves, and, there we go. It was my injury. The years I've worked. So, my back starts going downhill. I'm complaining this whole time now that, somebody's not paying attention. I need something done. After all time, I had people call me names like JP every day. And, at first, when I first heard it, I thought it was kind of funny. Because I figured, hey, I'm just going to have a temporary limp. I've got half my issues. I'll be all right. I'll get half of it. And I got to take it personal very quick because I realized my body is going further and further downhill. At this time, I had to go in for shots to my knee. And keep in mind that I've already started to make written complaints regarding the call names, about the chair incident. So they finally pulled me into a meeting. And that's when they wake me up. They rolled me up for a half CNC. And being out of work, I explained I've been out of work for doctor's appointments. In fact, the two other times that I had to leave early was because of my disability hearings. And that time you say my dog was depressed, it was not because my dog was depressed, it was because my dog had a surgery. So she chewed the stitches out and I had to go in for emergency because he was looking for white blood everywhere. I explained this to the doctor. And I told him, I said, I gave the paperwork. I gave all the information I had. Well, we've never seen it. Blah, blah, blah. What's this about the chair? And I explained to him again. Oh, we haven't seen any doctor's notice, and I did this upon hiring. But we don't know anything about it. But you do know something about it, and I'll have it back over again. At this time, they said, all right, well, as long as you just keep coming in on time, doing your better deal, and everything will be fine, so it's going to be right shot. I'm like, well, this is not so, whatever. So, I'm getting my knee shots. And, by the way, during this first meeting, Bob told me that the knee shot shouldn't hurt because he had them before. And steroid injections don't hurt. Just seemed to sort of go, I've never been bothered to have, but we're actually twice the shots to hurt like hell, like a cigar injury. And that's my kind of my problem, because assuming what was wrong with me, outside my doctor's records, my notes that I did bring in, they would just make up their own so-called facts of what was wrong with me and call it real. And that if I had something to show outside of that, I would thank her. It was very destructive. So I was getting my knee shots, and there were two flexors. My knee would swell up, like you wouldn't want to believe, make it very difficult to walk. My doctor recommended 24 hours off. They did not let me have that 24 hours off, and the knee shots did not hurt. to, you know, have that time off. They also got mad that they took an hour to get the doctor's appointment. I explained to them that he wanted instruction about Saturday 9, the infection of the Jews. He just said, bull. So either way you cut it, I was, you know, not doing so well. They just didn't believe anything I told them or anything they seen. So I'm going to work, company barbecue. This is only a day to get after the shot. My knee started much better. I had my pain. Now I'm scared to be gunsmith. I turn around my cane. Turn around to be a gunsmith. I'm like, you know, what's up with my cane? I don't know. I didn't see anything. Like, it was just right here. You see me with it. He's like, yeah, I know. And so he starts helping me look for it. Everybody else goes up to the company barbecue. So basically, we couldn't find it. And at this time, I'm almost in tears, and I'm sitting here lifting around a knee that I should not be putting my full support on. So I ended up finding a broomstick to help me walk around, you know, and I'm going everywhere. Maybe somebody hidden outside, you know, anything. I actually get outside, and the broomstick just didn't grab the ground right. My knee ended up giving out. I fall down on the sidewalk. Again, keep lifting people and things to the fire. All that. I felt shame. You know, I literally had to go to my car. I was tearing up. It didn't feel like me doing it. I was only going to stick up with people. And now I felt like I was at one. Nothing I can do. Nothing I can say. You know, I'm in a company where every day they're sitting there bashing people on welfare. They're bashing anything on the left side. You know, and it's meantime, you know, I'm hearing people, you know, that are on disability, you know, they insult people like this family. So, I mean, I'm pushing myself through, I'm trying to get through, not thinking it's personal. They keep telling me it's nothing personal, and yet things keep happening that seem quite personal. So, you know, they bring me in for more meetings, and they still keep telling me my behavior's an issue, and I said, what behavior? What are you talking about? You're walking around here in a friendly manner, you know, so I said, I have a limp that I even explained to people that sometimes you see a solid look on the machine on the pain. And the other accusation was like, I'm just walking away from the phone and not answering it, which is what I had to back that up. I couldn't back that up. And again, they made that accusation that I'm being rude to my customers, so I invited them. I said, listen to my phone call. Do whatever you have to do. I said, not being rude, just before, and I said, and I know that I'm getting at least one talking right in the week. People actually write me and taking their time. And I've seen multiple ones, and I said, well, they don't show anybody, I'm just throwing them right out. So at that time, I mean, it's like I'm just a liar. No matter what I say, no matter what I do, I can't do anything. You know, my body starts now going so far downhill, muscle spasms started dislocating vertebrae. Now, during this time, I was literally losing use of my arms. My right arm would cringe up. My fingers would look like a lobster claw. And I wouldn't be able to move them. You know, I'm going into work like this. And I finally get to the doctor, which I thought the doctor told me, you know, I'm screwed if I'm taking time off and I retaliate. He's probably going to take 48 hours off. When I come back in, they told me on Thursday to take time off, and I go back to work at the doctor's appointment, show them the note, and they actually were like, you can go home. I'm like, what? But yeah, you have to go home. Yeah, I know that the doctor's note says. He's like, yeah, you gotta go home now. I was like, okay. And I'm thinking, they've never done this to me. Before, when I said I had that doctor's note saying something like this, it's a hard time, something's wrong. So, this is on a Thursday. I come back in on a Monday. Probably get the weekend off. He told me I'm supposed to be here. What do you mean? Well, you know, the doctor knows that you have to pick up work, and you're not supposed to be here. They said to go back to the doctor and see him. I said, that's not necessarily true. I said, the doctor knows that I have 48 hours off, which is 48 hours off. I said, that is the understanding of the doctor's note. And I said, and I have the weekend off as well. And obviously you can see me here, right to work. He goes, nope, you gotta leave. And I said, you know, that's not true. I said, please double check with human resources something. I said, because I'm not gonna leave here unless I know it's, you know, the right rules and not be blamed later for, just getting up and leaving on my own. But he goes, well, I'm saying, well, you have to leave now. All right, whatever. I said, well, if you just in effect, take me off. I got to stop, walk outside, and see the human resources here, drop in the parking lot. And I said, Heather, the time is pretty much take me off. Said, what do you mean? I said, well, I've been parking lot for 48 hours. And, you know, and that was the deal last Thursday, and I actually go to the doctor. I said, my spine surgeon. I can't just make an appointment and get in there. And she's like, well, technically we can get away with the back note. I was like, well, that would be easy to do. I can give him a call and get that done within 5 minutes. I'm like, okay, so be it. So I get the fax note, gets it in. She gives me a call on my cell phone, so he can come in. I'm like, all right. So I get back in, you know, finish my day. A matter of days later, a customer calls in. He has a package he sent in. It was for the actual web shop department, which is mine. And there's this lady there that talked very bad about me. Get on my back. She was the same thing that she was going to get me fired. She made said statements to them to get me had the drug tested, which I did pass the drug test, mind you. And basically, I had a customer that called me on the phone and said he gave me messages that they couldn't get through. And he had this general that he was going to be presenting a ceremonial tummy gun during the weekend. And that nobody was going to call back and ensure that this happens by the weekend. And I told him, well, it's not my department. And, you know, and I told my transfer, and he's like, well, I've already tried that. Not working. I said, okay. And part of our job is to do the mail, too. If somebody calls in and says they're having an issue, the mailbox is right there. So if we can check and save somebody else time, so be it. I'll do it. Which Ian, my coworker, did all the time. That was never a problem. So I get up. I'm limping, as usual. I walk on over to the bin, which is about 2.5 to 3 feet away from her desk. And she pulls back in her chair and turns and then reaches over and smacks my hand away from the bar. Excuse me. I was like, I'm trying to look at a bag. She's like, that's my mail bin. No, it is not. I said, the company's mail bin. I said, I'm trying to do this for the customer to resolve an issue. I said, if you have something you need to do with the package later, then fine, so be it. All I'm doing is checking to see if the name is on there. So it was resolved. I went back to my desk. So a couple days later, I actually get pulled in again. You know, you're being written up for it. Like, are you kidding me? I'm like, no. And I said, you treated her with disrespect. And I said, the only thing I said to her is she can do what she needs to do with that package later. And I was just trying to do my job. I said, in fact, she assaulted me, and Tim knows that I told him. Tim, no, you didn't. Yes, I did, Tim, and you laughed at me. You thought I was joking. You know, this whole thing, I tell you guys when something goes wrong, doesn't work. But I tell you, you laugh at me. You joke. You tell me I'm being too sensitive when somebody takes my case. You tell me I'm being too sensitive when somebody plays in my chair and I get injured. I don't even have a right to file an accident report of these things.
It seems like just a little bit you've told us so far. I mean, it's almost like they brought you in specifically for the reason of their self-enjoyment and to torment you. I mean, I can't fathom why anybody would do these things, you know. And I don't doubt your story at all because we see it from these corporations. And I was trying to find, there was a link to a blog post, and I've somehow lost it, Rich. Maybe you can tell me what to search. But they are not just an arms dealer, but the owners of the company are tied to some pretty shady things, religious-type things, eccentric. I'm not even sure what the word is. But can you give me an idea of where to look so I can find that link and get it in the chat room?
These are things. I knew it was owned by the Moon family. If people look at the name Justin Moon or Reverend Sonia Moon, you know, basically you'll see some history there. And the story out there called Money, God, and Guns. And I later found this out after I started working about the Union Pager, so on. And, you know, when I looked into it, I've seen things like cocaine and running on the family. I mean, it just, the easiest way to say it is, what you told me was just hit it right on the head. I felt like people were literally doing this for their self-enjoyment, for their amusement. It didn't hit me at first. It didn't hit me until very much later, where it just all at once, at the very end of my employment there, it just felt like, holy shit. And then the reality hit me, my doctor telling me that I was going to be starting my, you know, all my physical therapy from scratch. It killed me. It absolutely killed me. And I'm going to get you that link and start taking care of it. I'm going to write up in your Facebook.
Oh, okay. I think I have it. That was written by Christopher Stewart, I believe. I found this, and it is the same story that I originally read. Maybe it's a reprint at rickross.com. It looks a little different, but I think it's the same thing. But, yeah, I read through that when you had sent it to me, and it just really raised a lot of questions in my mind. And, I mean, I'm concerned because I'm all for people owning guns. But when we have a gun manufacturer, dealer, that is this eccentric and, you know, tied to religion and all this weirdness, and then we hear they get their kicks off abusing disabled people, I have a real concern. You know,
they actually wrote things like in the MCAT complaint. They wrote things such as, because I believed in the union-type police, that made me a radical. And because I stuck up for the, you know, basically one of the people there at the very end stated when the Oaksterdam raids were happening in the cannabis facility, a lady stated, you know, I'm glad, I hope that they're all criminals, I hope they all get arrested. And I tried my hardest so long. I never spoke politics up until that moment, until I felt so stepped on, and I did speak up. And I said, excuse me, they're not all criminals. I said, a lot of them, and I said, in fact, I'm willing to say the majority of them have very legitimate issues. She goes, well, then they should be talking to pharmaceutical companies and, you know, take care of them that way. They mean the same pharmaceutical companies that refuse to test DCA because it's too cheap for them to make the money back quick enough. But, oh, that's just a conspiracy. I said, look it up. It's not just a conspiracy. It's fact. I said, it only takes a few minutes to look it up. You know, and these things happen quite often in the end. And they use these things to say that I was a conspiracy theorist, I was a radical, I had Buddhist symbols on my desk. They said that because I had strange religious symbols on my desk, they'd be, you know, too scary to be around firearms. They literally made me out to be like some sort of Frankenstein that runs around the office, eating babies. You know, and anybody that knows me knows I'm not like that. Not like that at all. You have to do a lot to torment me to get me to speak up. And when I do, I speak up. I say, hey, listen, you can't do this. It's not like I tried to go a deconstructive route. I did everything I could, write emails to all the company heads. And it's like the more I did it, the more I was laughed at, more I was tormented, the more I'd hear comments about how disabled people are just scumbags in society. You know, it drove me nuts. It drove me nuts. People damn torture is what it was. And then I start seeing about these people and, you know, the Unification Church, and I'm just like, you know, whatever happened to a church supposed to be a good thing? You know, one of the people there gave me a book one time about the Reverend Moon. You know, and this is supposed to be a good man. How did this happen? It blew my damn mind. I couldn't figure it out. It just made no damn sense. And then I went further and seen stories about the guns and, you know, how they were hiring people that had no background checks for heroin addicts. And it's like, holy shit, what did I get myself into? These people are sadistic and twisted.
Yeah, hey, Rich, I'm just communicating with the station here because for some reason Skype is really weird. The sound is shit, and we've been playing back and forth. I thought maybe it was because I was maxing my machine out. But what I'm going to have to do just for the sound quality, I know the chat room's having a hard time hearing us. I'm going to end the call, and the station is actually going to host. I was hosting this on mine, and because of the problems earlier, it may be my machine, it may be a Skype glitch, But we're going to just give us 2 minutes. We're going to reconnect and then call back in as you did. We're just going to try to reconnect to clear up this sound so that, you know, the audio on the archives, people can hear your story. Because from what I'm seeing in the chat room, we lost a few people that are having a hard time hearing you. And what I'm hearing is really cucka as well. So I'm sorry for the inconvenience, but we're going to end the call. And
ask your question, if you don't mind, real quick.
Sure.
Does this sound any better right now, or is it still doing the same exact thing?
There was a different tone, but it amounts to about the same thing.
All right.
Yeah, I think a lot of times Skype will do this, and then if you just hang up and reconnect the call, it mysteriously gets clearer. So it's kind of a last ditch, but let's try it. We're reconnected. Let's see. Hopefully that clears up the sound a little bit.
Sounds much better. Yeah, I got you. And that sounds much clearer on my end as well right now, too.
It does sound better. Okay, I got a message from the station, though. They're not hearing me. And I'm not muted. I don't know what's going on here. Let's see. No sound coming through. Okay.
Tell them to refresh their browser just in case they need to replay.
Yeah, we're going to do that. Sorry for the inconvenience, Rich. I'm going to end the call here. And they had you. We're back. Okay, we've got it. Good job over there. I'll tell you, I've got to give a big shout out and a big cyber kiss to Jewel. She works her ass off, and she's very good at what she does. So somehow. She's pulled it through. We have sound. You're sounding better to me. I'm sounding better to you. And hopefully it's sounding better in the chat room now. So, and I apologize, folks, for the audio earlier. People don't like this. It was very odd. And I can't confirm or deny that Carr Arms had anything to do with my inconveniences here. But I have been pretty active in making sure people know who was going to be on, what the topic was. And when I went to update everybody tonight, I was going nuts on that. And suddenly I suffered a fatal error. My computer never lets me down. This thing is a tank. But it did. And then I got it back up, and I had all these problems that I shouldn't have. My connection kept disabling itself. And so these things happen when we talk about sensitive topics or when we start addressing elitists, you might say. And so, again, I cannot confirm or deny what's going on, but I'm going to put it out there as fact, and that's the chain of events. And so we're doing what we can do to keep the show going, but... we can pick up where you left off there, Rich. I mean, these guys just tormented you. Kudos to you for putting up with it. I wouldn't have. I mean, when you talked about them hiding your cane, I mean, I'm the kind of guy that as soon as I found it, I might have used it to assault them after everything you told me. You know, that's just a lot of patience on your part to hang in there.
Well, I'm going to be honest. You know, I just wanted to succeed after laying, you know, and going what I went through, that car accident and not being a productive member of society for so long. I wanted to succeed. I was willing to let go and just not think of things and just try to move ahead and keep working as a human goddamn being. You know, that's what I wanted more than anything, to just feel as human.
Yeah, well, and I can appreciate that, and I can tell that's, you know, you were trying to do the right thing, and obviously it's not just that easy to just quit a job because there's things you don't like. But, I mean, you suffered abuse. There's no torment. There's no other way to see it. So kudos to you for hanging in there. But anyway, back to you, because you know more about it than I do, so I want to get it in your words.
Well, in the very end, you know, right after they wrote me up for being assaulted, yes, you know, write me up for being assaulted. The next day I went to go and pull in the parking lot, and, you know, keep in mind I barely slept that whole night. You know,
know, PTSD triggering. I just did not want to go in. But I went in, went to that parking lot, and I just started shaking like a leaf. My heart felt like it was going to jump to my chest. My head felt like my veins were going to explode. And I couldn't even move. I was just having a nervous damn breakdown of something of some sort. So I've never felt anything just that severe. So I texted that guy, Bob. I said, I'm like a meeting with Sam. I said, otherwise, I can't even go in this building anymore. I said, I can't do it. That was a text. He called me up. What's going on? I told him, I was like, listen, I told you guys everything that's going on. I made the complaints I'm at. I said, I'm at the point where I feel, and keep in mind, I got tears in my eyes at this point. I'm crying. As a grown man, I'm literally crying and breaking down. I told him, I said, I feel like if I walk in there, when somebody clubs me, I say, actually, some kicks. I said, somebody kicks me in the knee, and I say, ow, I'm going to get written up for it, and I'm going to be fired. But I said, I can't afford that after all I went through. I said, I've been through too much. I can't do it. I said, you guys are crazy. you got to calm down. You got to calm down. We'll get you the meeting. And Sam Wada is the absolute head of the warehouse. And my feeling is there's no way he could know what's going on here. There's just no way this is really happening, type thing. So he tells me that they're going to do the meeting and just calm down and go inside. Quite good. They pull me inside of another room after about 3 minutes at my desk. I'm shaking as I'm walking in. I did not want to be in there. But then again, I know what they would do if I didn't go in there. I'd be fired. Just create the game. So they bring me the office. It's just that guy and, not Sam, that guy Bob, and another lady that really has nothing to do with anything. And they just start going through the same crap again. Your behavior needs to change. And I said, your idea of my behavior changing is me just putting up with it. It's me just laughing when somebody calls me kids. Me just laughing when I fall in the park. I'm like, oh, that never happened. But I said, Bob, it did happen. Stop telling me it's bullshit. And he's like, oh, by the way, you got to stop threatening us. You wrote to your lawyer and whatever emails to us, too. I said, that was my car accident lawyer. And I said, and I have to write to him everything that goes on my back and the stuff that I go through is still an open case. I said, nothing to do with you guys. It cannot be used to just do that. He's like, well, you still don't have that right. I said, I do have that right. That's my car accident lawyer. I said, you can't say anything about that. He's like, well, I want to see all these medical records again showing that you're really disabled. And I was like, Bob, you don't have that right. I said, as a contractor, I said, I've already given all my medical stuff to everybody in the company multiple times. I said, and, he's made the statement before that just because they're not in my hand doesn't mean that they don't exist. I said, no, he said before that just because, he said before that unless they're in their hand, they don't exist. And, I'm against that because, again, I've turned in my medical record, I've turned in my medical bills, and it seems like every single time they want to get me, I want them on demand, and if I don't have them on demand, then they don't exist. And it's just insanity, And the first meeting, there's something I did want to bring up, too. I did bring up that chair situation again. And this is one of those things that I still can't get out of my head every day when I wake up. Doug Williams. During that first meeting, I brought up the chair again. I'm like, you guys still haven't got me. That's me going, but damn it, because you damn liberals are all the same. You just want everything for beliefs, and you just want everything for free. And that's the first time I said, damn it. I said, damn it, Doug, that's not an option for you guys. I said, that's the law. You're supposed to provide me with that chair. And, that's when things first started turning somewhat solid. But either way, toward the end of that last meeting, I then told them, I said, I'm going to go file a discrimination complaint. I said, I've had enough. I said, I can't take this anymore. And that's when he's just like, that's it. Get out of the building. Get out now. Just telling me to leave the building and told me that they're going to suspend me. With pay, they're supposed to suspend me. And I told him, I said, I know what that's going to turn into. That I know what your investigation's turned into. You've never done anything about the king. You've never done anything about the chair. I said, you find a way to blame me. That's what your investigations are. And the argument just continued on the way outside, and I just kept telling them, well, I found a discrimination complaint. You explain it to them, why people call me gay, and so on. And that was pretty much the end of it. So I filed for unemployment. I obviously do file the discrimination complaint, so on and so on. So I filed for unemployment. No time went by. And then on July 19th, I get a phone call. Bob. Well, I see him as he went through with the discrimination complaint. I said, absolutely. No way I'm going to let that go. And he goes, well, I also seen you apply for unemployment. I said, right. Well, good luck with that now.
So this was, I mean, I'm getting horrified listening to this story because, I mean, we have the appearance of they brought you in just to basically be their little toy for their perverted, wishes and just sick. And then there's the religious
aspect.
And there's also some political discrimination going on there. So, I mean, they're whaling you from all different angles.
Yes.
I mean, these guys...
Well, they actually admit this later, too.
Yeah, and that's something, you know, in the workplace, I mean, we've... unless everybody happens to be in agreement, it's something that should be left out of the workplace, the political and the religious part of it. I mean, because it never leads to a good... conversation. I mean, we all know that. I mean, politics have caused some of the greatest fights in human history, and so has religion. So for them to bring, you know, the politics in, and we already know that there's a religious aspect, and then we have, the injustice against a disabled person, and not just an injustice, like it was in an intentional, you know, like they brought you in just to be there. You know, it's like the guy in the yellow suit at the park with the candy in his pocket luring in, the little boy. It's on the same level as far as I'm concerned. I'm already horrified, but I'm sorry to interrupt.
Well, I'm going to find out. No, it's not a worry. I mean, I'm going to find out. I'm not the only one that's done this to. They have a bad habit of doing this to people that were in my position. In fact, I'd love to speak to a guy by the name of Sean Damaris, who I know they absolutely tortured to the point where he just got up and left one day. He's like, oh, I can't do it. He just blasted out of the building. Couldn't do it.
So they have a track record of doing just this?
Yes.
Do you have communication with some of these other people, or would you like communication with them so that you can put your stories together and possibly take some type
of...
Okay, well, just for safety's sake for now, because, you know, we will protect your email and all that. If anybody is hearing this that is in Rick's position, has been abused by Car Arms, forward your contact information to me, kevin@masterofmanythings.com, and I will forward that to Rick, and I will leave it up to his discretion to get back to you. But this is critical because, I mean, if it's happened to more than one person, because sometimes people, even when you tell them a story, and I know you're a sincere guy, I've watched what you're doing online, you know, and you're a real guy. You're not making this stuff up. I don't think that at all. But some people just automatically assume it's a story to get, you know, airtime or whatever they think, their ridiculous thoughts. But if we could get together several people that this has happened to, in the environment there at Car Arms, and we can show that this is repetitive behavior, it might go a long way to helping everybody involved. So please, folks, share this information. If we can get together everybody that was affected, that would be very powerful to stop this from happening to anybody else. So share the information. Shoot me an email. I'll pass it on to Rich, and then Rich can take it from there. And who knows, maybe in the near future, Rich, we could get a couple of you together and come back and revisit this a month or two down the line or something. But, I just want to throw that out there because that's the point of the show, to not just sit around and talk. And I think you know this, Rich. I'm not one to just sit around and bitch. I sit around and bitch a lot, but while I'm bitching, I try to take some type of action, because if you don't, what good is it? You know, if people don't
the reason why I'm doing this is, you know, number one, I feel like in order to have my dignity back, I need to stand. But the most important thing is that I can't stand knowing that this could happen to the next person that walks in there. So help me God, somebody is bound to just not be able to handle it. Somebody's bound to not be able to walk through that struggle. And if I ever heard of somebody, you know, not being able to live through that, or something very bad happened to somebody else, you know, I would partially blame myself, because whatever I see, I'm partially responsible for.
Well, I mean, somebody could die, Rich. That's as simple as that. And that's not, you know, hype or overreacting. You had a spine injury.
No.
Okay? And you're...
I could have been paralyzed.
Yeah, you could have been paralyzed. I mean, God knows what happened. So you don't have your cane, you trip and fall, and people have died from smacking their head on something. I mean, that's not created. I didn't create that to, you know, make some Alex Jones hype and overstate the circumstances. This is the real deal. Somebody could die in the hands of car arms with this, and this is repetitive behavior. Rich isn't the only one. So... You know,
people have died. May I say that people have died? If you read that story you put up, there was a kid that was shot. Basically, you know, honestly, I don't remember if he actually did die. Let me just rephrase that. But the idea was they didn't do background checks on all their employees. And they had a guy that was an alleged, you know, heroin dealer stealing guns at their company. And part of the problem they still face is they have people there that are very shady. In fact, a lot of the workers would question whether a lot of them were even documented, which for a firearm factory is not a good thing. They're supposed to do a background check on every single person there inside the company. You know, and then when I see your stories about people stealing things, getting caught, nothing happening to them, then I get written up for allegedly saying them. And I quote, unquote, out of luck to a customer. No joke. They literally wrote me up for that. It's just insanity, the things that happen. And, you know, one of the reasons I'm speaking out of this, too, is that I feel very comfortable, because there are people there that are willing to stand up. And I know that they're honest people. You know, and one of them, you know, is the right wing. The thing is, he was always the respectful one. He would speak his beliefs, and he would do it in a respectful way. You know, and he's one of those ones that, while I'm on the phone and I'm hearing these political conversations, he was always that one that was like, you know, no, I can't say that about people like that. You know, so on and so on. He's actually a town councilman. And I got to tell you, if he was my town councilman, I'd vote for him. And I've never voted rightfully. You know, and so, you know, either way, you know, I end up having to fight for unemployment. It's been since June 15th, and I find out from unemployment that basically they're denying that I ever told them anything about my disability, basically stating that I'm faking half of it, that they provided me the chair, that I actually said I was happy with the chair, that I never showed them any doctor's documentation, that when I had my doctor's appointments, I'd actually just get up and leave. Which, I did not do that. In fact, there was many circumstances, and I approve of it, to where the supervisor made me cancel my appointments only hours ahead. And these are appointments where I was going on my medications, where if I was the average person and they went without these medications, I could have literally went into seizures. But they didn't care about that. They were more worried about Ian's schedule. Ian was allowed to leave 2 days a week early. And yet, if I left one day a month early, I'd be written up for it. And I actually had to sign a piece of paperwork stating that, you know, the problem was absenteeism, you know, my doctor's appointments, and that I was not allowed to have any time off unless I actually had a doctor's note. Which, you know, again, a whole different set of rules from everybody else. You know? So I had to bring up these things in unemployment.
That's kind of ridiculous, I mean, for them to make the statement that you didn't tell them about your disability. I mean, it sounds like it would be something that would be very hard to hide. You wouldn't be able to lie about it and then go perform your job without anybody knowing. I mean, from day one, it would have to be pretty obvious that you had a disability. So, I mean, that, you know, I can't even believe
that. I've had a slight limb since 2008, you know, at least a slight limb. When I started working there, like I said, it was a slight limp, but I did have a limp. In fact, I worked so hard to get that limp to a minimal. I mean, I'm missing cartilage in my knee. You know, it's not like I can hide the fact that when that bone grinds, it hurts like hell. You know, and these are the things that drove me nuts. So Bob's idea was, you know, because the limp wasn't bad that one day, but the next day it was bad, that I was faking. So their ideology is doing it bad. That's their proof that I really didn't need these medical things. That their ideology is that I didn't really need that chair because I looked happy. But I wasn't looking happy. In fact, you know, I was walking in there fearing my chair. I literally said to my supervisor. I said, you know, when I come in the mornings, I literally fear my chair. No one was going to do to me. That's not the way somebody should have to work. You know, and all people don't tell, you know, earn your chair. You know, then I hear the back comments of people behind me, you know, oh, those damn welfare people, and how we want things for free, and, you know, it's just disgusting.
Can I ask you, Rich, what the hell do they mean by earn your chair? It's like they're holding a candy bar in front of a kid's face. Or, you know, a dog in front of a dog and making him dance. It just sounds like these people are twisted and sick. Like, earn your chair. What the hell does that mean?
It disturbed me. I mean, I'll tell you that much.
It really did, and that's why these things shit my head
every day. And that's what people don't understand is when people like me have PTSD, until we have some sort of victory, until we see something done that helps us to, you know, tell these people they're wrong, until we have that victory for even just unemployment, we hear being called gimpy all day in our heads. We hear that you're not worthy of even a chair all day in our heads. We're trying to go to sleep. These are things that just run through and run through and run through until we get past it, until we have our victory. And that is why I needed to file a discrimination complaint. This is why I need to speak, because if I don't have my victory, I fall. I can't let that happen. After 36 years of my life that I struggle to be a damn good human being to everybody around me, and those especially damn close to me know the heart that I have to the people around me. They know that even people I might not agree with, even the political views, when they come to me in pain or need help, I put down everything I can. You know, well, even now, the truth of the matter is I'm half broke because I decided to give somebody some cash that I haven't gotten paid back for in over a year. I could have had another $5,000 in my pocket to go on. Instead, I decided to save a guy's dog's life. You know?
You know, and what I'm seeing, too, is I've interacted with a lot of people, especially up in this area, that, you know, when they get a small ailment, they have it in their mind that they can beat the system and go apply for disability, and they're not legitimately disabled, or others that are legitimately disabled but could do something to provide for themselves as far as work, but they don't because they're in a comfort zone. Now, you went outside of your comfort zone. You pushed your disability and your limits so that you could be a productive individual and not take from the system, and they just... You know, that what they did could stop you and other people from even trying. And we're in the middle of this economic collapse. We need as many people providing for themselves as we can. And we have corporations like Car Arms who are making it impossible for people to do that, breaking your spirit. I mean, I wouldn't honestly blame you if you didn't try to ever work again, because why the hell would you? You did. You went out of your way. You pushed your limits, and you got treated like shit. You were abused. You were ridiculed. and tormented. Why would anybody try under those circumstances?
You want to hear the fucked up thing?
Yeah. I have heard a lot of fucked up things, Rich, but one more is.
Here's a messed up thing. You know, meanwhile, while I'm hearing them call me lazy, while I'm also seeing people online call the people on disability lazy, while I'm seeing this and hearing this, I want you people to understand that I could have been on disability my whole life if I wanted to. I bear the scars, but I didn't want that for myself. I wanted something greater. I wanted to call myself successful. I wanted to wake up and know that I went and did something that made a difference for somebody else and myself. And when I went on disability, keep in mind that I had my hearings while I was at CAR. I was given the option of staying at home and literally making more by sitting at home than if I went to work. I chose to go to work. Even though I was going to take home less, even though I had to struggle more, I went to work and I chose that for myself. So anybody out there that says it's an easy ride for disability and, hey, you know what? Fuck you.
Yeah, absolutely.
I stood up and I still tried to did everything I could. And you people that sit there and judge, when you sat there and pointed fingers at somebody that sat there working in a company like that, when you sat there calling names and you sat there doing that, that was somebody that was literally working harder to make less and by choice. Because they wanted that self-pride. They wanted to know that that's what they wanted out of their life, is to work and to get past what they were told they wouldn't be doing so quickly. You know, and that's what bugs me the most.
Yeah, I mean, this whole situation beat the hell out of you. Rich, it's the top of the hour, so we're going to go to a short break. I've got a little something special lined up. There was a commercial, actually. We're going to start with that. It's about a 3-minute commercial that was put out by Natural News, and it's in relation to the TSA, but I think that people listening will see that it's really in line with what CAR Arms represents, and so that'll play. That's kind of fun. And then we're going to roll into a couple of songs by an underground hip-hop artist, Ghost Rider. Some of you have heard him here before. And I'll drop some links in after the break where you can find Ghost Rider. If you, the listener, or anyone you know is new music and they want to get their music aired here at the break of Voice of Humanity or mixed in on the Monday Hacker News Show, shoot me an email, kevin@masterofmanythings.com. It's part of what I'm trying to incorporate with both the shows is to give unsigned artists a little more exposure, and it helps me because it fills my break. It makes it a little outside of the box, you might say. So, but this TSA commercial, it's really funny as hell, and it kind of represents what I'm hearing from you about CAR Arms. So we'll break now, Rich. If you want to go ahead and hang up 8 minutes from now, we'll be back live again. Just go ahead and call back in. And for the listeners, enjoy the commercial break. We'll be back with you again in 8 minutes. And our guest today, Rich Fu, activist, disabled worker who was abused, mistreated, tormented by gun dealer CAR Arms. And we'll be back with you momentarily.
The TSA needs your help to protect America's national security. Highly trained TSA officer, you'll get a plastic badge. Oh, yeah, you brawl. But that's not all. No education needed. No IQ too low. Not even yours. And as a federal TSA officer, you get to harass everyone around you, just like you did in high school. Yo, check this out. You also get to feel some genitals. No, not your own. Other people's genitals. Plus, you're fully authorized by Janet. The Politano. Undressed innocent travelers where there are no security cameras and awesome power. When an environment is always comfortably warm, thanks to the ionizing radiation being constantly emitted by X-ray machines and naked body scanners. But don't worry, even if you do get cancer, we've got government healthcare for you for all the psychiatric drugs that turn you into a complete psychopathic criminal. This even more awesomer. Many power tripping perks. Do you enjoy undressing little boys and girls like this, say, for barcodes? Do you like to detain U.S. senators? Do you appreciate portable electronics that slide easily into your pocket? Have you ever wanted to see what's really hiding in Grandma's cupboard? Well, now's your chance. Perks, come join the TSA. You a badge, a uniform, and an ego trip the size of the federal budget deficit. Plus, you'll get a paycheck denominated in fiat currency, Federal Reserve notes.
Oh, yeah.
In the TSA, you'll be working alongside 65,000 other fine men and women and workers who represent the security elite, the last line of desperate defense.
Stopping my grind. If you're rolling with me, we about to set it off. You ride on these haters till the wheels fall off. 'Cause
ain't nobody stopping my shine. There ain't nobody stopping my blood.
Yeah, oh, Friday here I come, tell the world, get ready, tell them haters they don't want none. I'ma show these suckers how to get them out of their seat. Every club go bananas when they bang this beat. Ladies all around the world gon' party with this. Every baller in your city got his name on the list. Throw the top back, baby, let it blow in the breeze. You the hottest little thing that the boy ever seen. Been a long time, been a real long grind, but I ain't never let them stop me, money stay on my mind. And it feels so good, getting paid, self-made. Like I found shade on a hot summer day. Damn, they gon' feel this here. Middle fingers to the haters, sorry, this my year. Flow so hot, they say I flow so cold. Either way you look at it, boy, I'm out of control. Feel so good, I wouldn't change for nothing. Party don't stop until we see the sun coming. Set the city on fire, we up all night. Making music round the world, baby, this is the life. Feel so good, I wouldn't change for nothing. Party don't stop until we see the sun coming. Set the city on fire, we up all night. Making music round the world, baby, this is the life. I'm in the fast lane, smoking. Dip it on you slow pokes. Haters getting mad, they ain't getting no dope. Never try to play me, I'm an underground vet. 50,000 out the trunk, another 50 off the internet. So clean, so fresh, so fly. Every time I ride by, I see the hate in AI. Think a pitch with pride, got more money to make. Steam coming out of ears, getting red in the face. I ain't tripping on the rules, I got moves to make. Pro man riding bikes, and I'm filling up the tank. Think he's flat like a doormat, hit him with the shank. Lay a hater down, then I'm off to the bank. I ain't making this water, I know where I'm at. I've been all around the world, and I'm still intact. Matter of fact, y'all haters are the reason I'm here. Exterminate your roses, I'm the player of the year. Feel so good, I wouldn't change for nothing. Party don't stop until we see the sun coming. Set the city on fire, we up all night. Making music around the world, baby, this is the life. Feel so good, I wouldn't change for nothing. Party don't stop until we see the sun coming. Set the city on fire, we up all night. Making music around the world, baby, this is the life.
Okay, folks, I am back with you, and I apologize for the dead air. There was a fail on my Winamp that should have continued playing music for you, and it looks like it did not do that. So my apologies. I'm back with you, and Rich should be joining us again here any minute. He should be calling in momentarily. What a story, though, and hopefully you guys will spread this information around and we'll get some more support for Rich. When he comes back, we'll get into probably some of the details of his court that he just went to, I believe, yesterday. And I think that was encouraging for him. I don't know if a final decision has been made or not as far as him getting his worker comp benefits, but we're going to hope for that. You know, he's really down in a tough spot because of all this. And what a story. I mean, I'm quite pissed off, actually, about it, to think that, you know, we have, think about this, we have a fanatical, religiously driven corporation that likes to abuse disabled people and has strong political views to left, right, or wherever the hell they're going, and they okay. Geez, folks, I'm having a heck of a time tonight. Rich called, and instead of adding him to the group, I answered it and put us on hold, so he'll call back momentarily. What a mess. I've been running all day, it seemed, and dealing with this computer. We'll try to get Rich back right now.
Alrighty.
Gotcha. All right, Rich, you're with us. I apologize, man. I have been running all day, and then this computer earlier, my Winamp didn't work. It should have played that commercial, which I thought was kind of funny, and then 6 minutes of music. And that failed, and then when you called, instead of adding you to the group, I answered it, and so that put the station on hold, and we were a mess, but we're back.
Ain't no worries at all, man. I don't mind that at all.
I was explaining that it was just yesterday or the day before, I believe, you finally had a hearing on all of this. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, basically in the hearing, they just denied. They denied I ever showed them any doctor's notes. They denied that I was unhappy with my chair. They stated in the beginning they never told me to get that physical from my doctor, which, you know, they told me to go, so they've been kept liable of, you know, what's wrong. In other words, just to make sure you can do this. You know, and I absolutely was. I was more than happy to do that, and I got the proper doctor's notes. And they deny ever doing that, never even seen the doctor's notes. You know, and that's what the hearing was about. It was just, I didn't even know what to think. You know, how can somebody deny all this? And here's the messed up thing. Right on the MCAT complaint that I have, they wrote in their own words that upon the first interview, I told them that I suffered injuries upon two accidents. Upon a car accident. And that, you know, I'm going to need special attention and all this stuff, and I was going to need one appointment a month. And they admitted this, and they said that that's one of the reasons why they hired. And they wrote this right on paper, but yet in the unemployment hearing, they say the complete opposite. Oh, we've never even heard of anything like this. You know, in the unemployment hearing, I mentioned that I had my two disability hearings, first one in September, second one October, while I was working there. Oh, I had no clue about that. I just got up out of my desk and just walked into my hearing, didn't tell anybody about this stuff. You know, well, and I'm just,
if
yeah,
I mean... If I can just throw this note in there now, I can't say for sure because I don't know the laws where you are, but to my knowledge, in most cases, when a company hires a disabled worker, there are federal programs that give tax breaks and or compensation for the labor paid out so that corporations will hire disabled people. So we could believe that Carr Arms, while they were getting their jollies, was actually, in a sense, getting paid for you to be there by the federal government. Now, I don't know the specific laws where you are, but I know many times that is the case, that the corporations...
I got to say, if that is the case, I'm going to be pretty, you know, that pisses me off. And that would really piss me off. I'd kind of rather not know if they're getting paid extra, maybe, at this point.
Right. Yeah, well, and if they've done this repeatedly, Rich, I'm going to think that unless it's all, you know, to get their jollies, there has to be a motivation to treat people like this. And, you know, you know that it's happened more than once. I'm going to have to assume, and it's not an assumption. I mean, it's a, you know, an educated guess that they did receive some type of compensation, whether it be through tax breaks or payback of labor that they paid out, however it works. But
I do know that I fell into certain tax categories to give breaks. I know that's my unemployment dealing with them. However, I don't know what a company does to get those. I don't have the slightest clue about any of that, so I really can't even speak. I just know there are tax breaks. For people that don't work for so long, I don't know about disabled, but definitely had to work for so long.
Right. Yeah, I'm going to do a little research on that. There's a gentleman that, and actually eventually here, he will, I believe, become a host and bring a legal show to the network. I'm going to run this by him and see what his knowledge of it is, because this would be important, you know, in the future, if we can get you together with some of the other people and we can present that information, and if that did occur, well, then Carr Arms, quite honestly, in my opinion, need to be taken out of business anyway. That's my thought. If you're going to treat anyone this way, disabled or not, you have no right being, you know, this big corporation, and especially you sell guns to people. And you have this, you know, perverted sense of humor, or whatever it is, they have no business doing business. And if they have manipulated for their own pleasure, the system, you know, to get kickbacks from the government, and the whole time they're also tormenting these people that they're basically getting paid, because if you get a tax break, that's like getting paid. I mean, it's money in your pocket. There is profit to hiring disabled people. Many companies do that because of the benefit, financial benefit. And so if we can line up all these dots, we could go a long way to making sure that this does not happen, whether they get disqualified from getting benefits like that in the future, or whether their licenses get pulled, or whatever we can do. Because as far as I'm concerned, and I take this upon myself, and I say that because when I put the video out, you did not ask me to do that. I did that because that's who I am, and that's what I do, and because I chose to do that, and I felt like it needed to be done. But they accused...
Can I add something really quick, too?
Sure.
You know, given what that did to my mind, and you know, given how I've struggled lately, I got to be honest, where I wasn't even sure I was going to mentally make it to the point of my hearing. And I went online, and I said, somebody, please help. I said, I can't do this no more. I feel like I'm dead. I feel like I'm literally dead inside. And I have to use the term that this is killing me. And it really is. And, you know, the minute I seen somebody stand up and help me out, to be honest, is the minute I've been able to pick myself back up and go, you know, do what I have to do. Simple fact of the matter is, you know, it's when somebody else helps me stand and puts together their effort, I have no choice but to stand on my feet at that point. And so I don't let them down, too. So that's who I am. So with that said, I am going to keep standing and do what I got to do.
That's awesome, because you really broke a lot of ice, you know, not only for yourself. It's good for you to do this, to take that stand and you know, to get out there, but it's going to be a benefit to somebody else, somewhere else, you know. And I'm just going to, you know, I say this because I see that they manipulate situations, and I'm going to make a clear statement that I'm taking this upon myself to do further research. And Car Arms, you can expect me to dig into this a lot deeper and make myself available to anybody else that has been abused by you. And I will address this again in the future. I don't know to what degree. It depends on what I dig up. But, you know, and I'm not, Rich, I told you, I'm not a computer guy. I only learned to even operate one, turn it on, 4 years ago. You know, but I learned quick, and I have a lot of friends, and most of them I've never even met. And many of them have skills that we can't even fathom, research-type skills, access to information-type skills. So in the coming days, weeks, whatever, I will reach out to them, and I'll try to dig up the law, other things, because this is important to me. There is a corporation in my country that is selling not just any gun. I mean, they sell all kinds of really, you know, fanatical guns. Gatling gun, is it, or whatever the hell?
No. Well, get this. This is something I know of that makes me very disturbed while I was there. Keep in mind that I believe in doing the right thing, and I had a lot of customers call me about the barrels blowing out. And I had a couple of them that said they went out to shoot, and on the first shot, the barrel launched out of the gun.
Oh, isn't that one?
This is very disconcerting to me, to hear about a firearm, especially one that could be in a youth's hands, you know, first-time shooters, somebody that might not, you know how to protect themselves properly. And come to find out, what was going on is because of the labor they were hiring was completely unskilled, and this is where a lot of accusations were in the office of undocumented workers and so on. They weren't twisting the barrels on properly. And what we were doing is we were literally blaming the customer for it. Oh, it's bad ammo, every time, bad ammo. And, hey, just send the gun in, it's bad ammo. And this would result in the customer paying for it. And they would have profit from the ammo companies, but the ammo companies would see it and say, oh, no, you know, nothing we're going to do. So So they have Tommy guns and, you know, basically the rifles that would have barrels popping off, barrels blowing, and they were literally making the customer pay for something that they know full well was happening. In fact, when the new guy came in, he literally stopped entire batches of rifles from going out because the barrels were not on correctly, knowing full well how many have gone out there like that, and they were still blaming the customer. It was disgusting to see some of that kind of stuff going on. And, you know, again, and when I look at what's going on with me, it's like, it's the same exact thing. Same exact thing.
You know, I mean, it makes me want to ask the question, how the hell does this happen? We're in the United States of America, and we have this corporation that has done all these things. I mean, the abuse on you and the torment and, you know, the political thing, you know, tormenting you more because of your political views. And now we find out that, you know, they sell guns. That concerns me. But not only that, but they sell guns that blow up on people. How the hell does this happen? Who's doing anything about this? You know, something needs to be done about it. I, as a human, can't sit back and know all these things and not do something about it. I mean, I just can't. It's not within me to ignore this. And again, so I will independently on my own behalf go where I go from here. I'm not going to make any threats or accusations, but I am going to do an intense amount of research, and I am going to revisit this topic again. I mean, this is just ridiculous. We can't allow.
For what it's worth. I was going to say, for what it's worth, I mean, from what I've seen online, what I've looked around with, a family has been known to bring, you know, grocery bags full of money home, millions of dollars. They have many shadow companies that seem to pop up, disappear. Money's transferred back and forth, all in the name of the Unification Church. And Connor Arms is one of those companies that seems to be standing for quite a while, but, you know, around Connor Arms is a lot of shadow companies. And that's where, you know, a long time ago they were investigated. Basically, it just all of a sudden went silent. And, you know, Connor Arms is, or I should say the Unification Church, has spent a lot of time buying up newspapers, media. They own, I guess, the majority of the share, industry for ginseng. I'm bringing it from Korea. I mean, they're like pop stars over in Korea, you know, and now they just come over, and they're given what I've read about the Unification Church. It's like, you know, I hear that we're cattle, you know, and they just can't wait for us to start slaughtering each other so they can rule the world, rule America, you know, and I'm like... just blowing my mind because it feels like I got right in the middle of it, even as just some nobody that walked in there for a simple, you know, very low paying job.
Right.
A job making one third of what I ever made in my old career.
Yeah, and what you're telling us, I mean, I can just see that because we know all the division that's being created here in the country and around the world, because people are waking up to all kinds of things. And so we have these shadow governments, secret societies, corporate manipulations, financial manipulations, all this stuff going on, causing division. People are infighting. I see it all the time. Different groups they're just fighting, and there's all this shit going on. So what you're telling me just kind of falls into play with what a lot of activists are seeing across the board, you know, like, for instance, the Occupy movement. On face value, it seems like a great thing. You think that, you know, it's the American people standing up, and some of it is. But other research will tell you that it's funded by a socialist movement to create infighting and collapse our economy. And so we have all this shit going on, and it's because of companies like Car Arms, quite honestly, that, or a big reason that we're in this shit, between them and the politicians And obviously they have a very strong political view. And generally speaking, when anyone with any financial resources has that strong of a political view, they're also sending money to the people on their side of the politics. So,
well, they donated, for example, and it sickens me. It's like I'm so conflicted to see things like this, but they donated, I think, like $50,000 to Wounded Warrior Project, which it's like, I love to hear when they get money like that. My God, they deserve 10 times more, if not, you know, much more than that. But it's like when I remember, and I sit here and think about what they did to me and how they say, oh, well, we're going to help the disabled. You know, it's like bullshit. Bullshit. What you took out of me, personally, just to get laughs out of people. I mean, and then, you know, you call it right by giving $50,000 to the Wounded Warrior Project. It's like, I still can't let it go.
Quite honestly, Rich, they can probably afford to give away $50,000 to their buddies because they stole it from people like you or through you from the government with kickbacks and whatever they get for hiring disabled people. I mean, this is, I really think after everything you've told us tonight that, and I hope that this will, you know, open up some investigations into Car Arms, these shadow companies that they're building up, you know, audits, whoever needs to get involved. Somebody needs to get involved at the federal level. And if they don't, quite honestly, this information has been put out public. It'll be shared repeatedly. It's not a far stretch to imagine that somebody with some type of authority within the government will hear about this, and if they don't take action against it, then the American people only, you know, have to believe that, well, there's a deeper hole to look into here. So, I mean, and maybe I'm assuming too much, so I'll stop myself. But
Not really, because their supervisor, for example, Doug Williams, I guess is an ex-captain of police. You know, and that's one of my fears is, you know, when I'm standing up to these people, I'm standing up to people that do have some, you know, political connections, you know, police and so on. They supply police a lot of their undercover guns, you know, secondary guns, you know, and some of the things that I've been told, such as from Bob, that he knows everybody in the industry, good luck getting a job in this industry. And then I hear people saying that, you know, they're afraid of me and all this shit. You know, I passed their Corey background check, and I'm wondering if anybody ever did any other background checks on me that were not so legal. Because, you know, at this point, I don't know what these people are capable of. I know that when it comes to Unification Church itself, there's not much they're not capable of. But when it comes to, you know, the people that work there and what they've done already, I don't know how far they're gonna, you know, go to dig out information on it. You know what I'm saying? I'm sure there's probably a sign somewhere that they've done that are legal, like use the NIC system, use a background check on it, for example. You know, I'm wondering, I don't even know how to check if they've done something like that. So if anybody has information to see if the NIC system was ever used for an illegal background check, I'd greatly appreciate it.
Yeah, because it sounds like, in my opinion, they're capable of anything that pops into their small little minds. You know, to do all these things, I mean, just to treat any human being the way you've described is just horrible. And then when you add in all these other factors, I mean, these people need to be stopped. It's like Hitler is on the rampage, you know, and somebody's got to do something about it because... And they're not the only ones. I mean, we see this all the time. You know,
I literally feel like they're trying to get me to just starve out or just, you know, die off. You know, and again, 6 months waiting for my hearing to finish. You know, it's like I've done so much to save my house.
Well, my quite house honestly, Rich.
It's a foreclosure, you know, and it's like, what do I do to win this? Yeah, I have the right complaints out. Yeah, I have the... You know, and by the way, I was given advice to file workman's comp and do some other things, which I am following that advice now. I thought that because if because I had a previous injury, that it wouldn't fall into it. And from what I'm told now is that it definitely does. So I'm going to be filing workman's comp as well. Because, you know, obviously I don't feel as if I should pay for all the medical stuff all over again. That's just ridiculous. That's years and years of medical treatments. Well, no, I shouldn't have to pay for that out of my own pocket. Not profit.
Well, yeah, and you've had to have additional medical attention because just because of the treatment at Car Arms, aggravating your existing conditions.
Stated on paper by my doctor stating that because he didn't have this chair, his condition has worsened. It's clear on paper by my own doctor's words.
Yeah, and just to kind of jump back for a second on what you had said, you know, I don't know. I kind of lose my train of thought when I get this pissed off. But, you know, what you had said, you didn't know if they were waiting for you to starve out. Most people won't. Once they get pushed to the degree that you have, they do end up quitting. And many don't even start the fight because, I mean, there's a lot of factors. We've been fluoridated since the 50s. That creates passiveness, removes critical thinking. So in general, we have that stifling effect, like the whole country is on fucking Prozac, you know, and then you have the other intimidation factors, circumstantial factors, you know, say you lose your home and you have to move across country and you can't show up to your hearing. So they do. They push, and many people will just kind of bow down, or maybe not even bow down, but be eliminated from taking action, because it takes a long time. And when you're in physical pain, you can't get around, you don't have the resources, it's very hard to fight against this. So I really hope that...
The worst is the minute you stand up for yourself, you know, the minute you raise your voice, you know, and you know, for me, for example, I was writing emails left and right when this happened. You know, I wasn't going to take it. And their emails weren't threatening. They were explaining, you know, this is how I feel. It's just twisted. This is messed up. You know, and people need to understand that when people like me that have gone through the trauma that we have to do something. We have to do something. And at that point, I mean, somebody in my position, losing everything that you've worked for and struggled for years upon years, you do what you can. And you remain productive, and that's what I tried to do. I did not want to act out of anger. I did not want to act out of violence. I wanted to work and do this the right way, file the complaints. You know, and then that's what they use against you. Oh, you're a crazy person for standing up and saying something. Oh, you're crazy. You hid your own pain on yourself. You know, and then it's insanity. It's insanity. And that's what our society teaches you. Is the guy that stands up and yells, he's the crazy guy. No, he's the guy we have to listen to and say, why are you yelling? What is the deal? And you know what? I do give a shit. I do want to hear it. And then you listen to their battle, you listen to their pain, and you find out that they're not so crazy after all.
Absolutely.
We change the shit.
Yeah, and I do see it. You know, I got quite discouraged for a while. And on to some level I still am, because I don't see enough people standing up. But I do see it, that people are, you know, we've been in so many ways oppressed so much that you finally snap. And a lot of times I think they do that on purpose, so that when you finally do take action, you don't handle it like you do, Rich. You know, you do have to maintain, no matter what, a level of respect. And I know I'm one to talk, because I say, you know, fuck you to anyone that I think needs to hear it. But what I've also found is, you know what, quite honestly, I like to be respectful, but I also understand that many times people do not listen until you grab them by the fucking neck and make them understand that you're not going to tolerate this shit anymore. Okay, because they don't listen. Please and thank you and could you and all this other shit, for many people doesn't work. They laugh at you. You know,
that's what happened to me. I mean, I was already complaining about people throwing in my chair, and they're like, laughing at me while I'm complaining. You know, and it's like, this could have paralyzed me. Why is it funny? Why is this a freaking joke to people?
Well, because they're sick and twisted in the mind. I mean, I can't explain it any other way. It's demented. I mean, you had given me, you know, a decent overview here a little while ago, but you've brought up a bunch of stuff. I was pissed off enough. Obviously, you know, like the day I did that video, when I really I was able to take a few minutes and look into this stuff that's going on with you. And now I'm learning even more about these people. And it may be good that I didn't know all that at the time, because I probably would have went on a nonstop assault of them, you know, and so that pause is nice, you know,
well, check
because
this out. In the hearing, and this gives you a good idea of the mentality we're dealing with. Towards the end, Bob brings up, he goes, oh, by the way, speaking of the whole cane thing, he goes, check this out. And he shows the guy a paper. And I'm wondering, you know, what the hell is this? And it's from the new supervisor that took over. And it says that during what happened with that incident with the cane is Mr. Merrill misplaced his cane. He hung it up high in the cage, which I usually never hang anything up by because it's hard for me to reach. And if I blow out my nerve while I'm doing that, I mean, I'm not doing so well. So I always keep things at arm reach level. And he said that basically I went for an entire day without my cane. And I did not make an incident out of it until the following day because I still had to use the same broomstick to help myself, you know, walk. And I looked at the hearing officer and said, this is crazy. I'm like, I'm telling you, I said, Bob, are you suggesting that I went an entire day without my cane? He's like, well, that's what it says. And I said, I'm telling you, I only went for an hour without my cane, and that's because I had to run around the building searching for it, and I actually fell, you know? And he goes, well, the paperwork there clearly says that you went a day. And I said, so what you're saying now is somebody else knows what I went through more than me, better than me. He goes, well, yeah, that's the paperwork. I just shook my head. I'm like, this is insanity.
Who filled out the paperwork?
Somebody that wasn't even in the situation knows exactly what happened way more than me as the one reporting it. You're telling me how long it went without my cane. It just, I couldn't help but just shake my head. I'm like, this is insanity. I don't know what to even think about this thing. Well, how can anybody clearly do that?
Well, I think that this kind of stuff starts in increments. You know, these companies or even individuals, when they do these type of things, they start out a little bit and they get away with it. So they do a little bit. It's like a drug addict. You do a little bit and you get away with it. So you do a little more, you do a little more, you do a little more. But they seal their own fate because they cross enough lines that finally somebody's going to stand up. And I mean, that somebody's you, Rich. I applaud you because you do put yourself in harm's way when you go up against these corporations. I mean,
I thought, when I went to an unemployment hearing, I thought I was going to end up having a nervous breakdown while I was in there. And I went in there fearing this. Because understand that whether I win or not is the thing. It's fearing. When you present a doctor's paper and hear that it's bullshit, you know, it's these things that drive us crazy. When I'm told that all the reality isn't real, I'm just imagining it. You know, it's crazy making. It's just absolutely crazy making. So, I went into that hearing knowing that I had a full chance of just freaking the hell out with knowing that this all just hit a level where I just couldn't deal with the bullshit no more. But I got through it and I kept calm and, I did what I had to do.
Well, it's awesome, you know, because you did. I mean, and you know yourself, you know, so what you just told us, you know, I wasn't even thinking of it along those lines. I was thinking of it more like when you go up against these corporations and you have evidence that will blacken their record, so to speak, quite often you end up dead. I'm just going to tell you. I mean, look at the people related to the BP oil spill. What is it, 13 mysterious deaths? So for you to do this, and I mean, you're a smart guy. You're aware of the things going on in the world. You know that you're putting yourself at risk, but you're continuing on because it's the right thing to do. And obviously now we know that there are other people out there that have gone through the same thing from the same company. And I mean, I knew that your story would touch somebody. I never fathomed that it would touch somebody possibly at Carr Arms. I mean, I kind of was looking at this like it was an isolated situation. And not that I'm happy it happened to more than one person, but now I am, because if we can get those people together, there may be further action that the group of you can take, and maybe, you know, the country will be less one more corporation that doesn't deserve to exist, quite honestly. And that's my opinion of them. I don't need to, you know, walk in your shoes and live your life and see it for myself. I trust you, and I know how these corporations act, and obviously you have a solid basis for what this isn't a made-up story, in other words.
I have it all on paper. I mean, I have the, and now with the unemployment hearing, I have them directly lying on record. I have them directly lying with either MCAT or unemployment. You take your pick at this point, because they're making up different stories for each one. You know, so this is at the point level to where, you know, I got to be honest, this has nothing to do with money. My unemployment, I earned that. If it comes down to workman's comp, you know what, I earned that too with my pain and suffering. But if it comes down to any money with discrimination or something like that, I want Carr to understand that it's not about the money. I can't help but, let's say, I've expressed my morals and who I am so much in my life, and it's not about the money. In fact, you know, I will say this right now, that if Carr did certain steps to completely eliminate a couple of employees out of their company that did cause this problem and publicly apologize, I would let everything go. It's as simple as that. If they let go of the employee that caused this problem and made a public apology and said, we apologize for the treatment of this worker, you know what? I would let it all go 100%, and I would feel comfortable with that. But until I see that day, you know what? If a lawyer named a number and states it, you know what? I'm fine with it. I don't give a crap what number they say. Whatever number any lawyer wants that they think is appropriate, you know what? I'll go for it. But for me, it's worth more than $50 million, because this is worth about the soul and integrity of people. And no amount of money is going to make these people turn their soul, turn their integrity around to actually be human beings. It's anti-life, it's anti-soul people that they have shown themselves to be to me.
Well, that's outstanding, and I fully believe you, because I know this isn't money motivated. You know, there's enough evidence of that, and I'm kind of on the same level as you. You know, I could give a shit about money. I just want the truth. I just want the right thing done, because in general, the country is too much of a mess, and we got to deal with it one piece at a time. And again, many times it's because of situations just like this. We have these corporations running rampant, doing whatever the hell they want, and taking, I mean, again, most people in your situation wouldn't have even gone and looked for a job, Rich. They would have said, hey, all I got to do is kick back, eat some pain pills, pay all my bills when my check comes in on the first, and I do whatever the hell I want. They would not look for work. And so when
I had good money on my disability, too. It's not like I was bringing home, you know, the minimum. I was bringing home pretty good money with that disability, you know. And like I said, when I was working, I was making less. And I, you know, there's many other people out there that choose to do that. And yet there's still people that will point that finger and say, you're lazy. You know, that's bullshit. That's bullshit. That's what we need to do in this country, and start paying attention to each other.
Yeah.
Look at each other's battles and struggles. That person that you once looked at and pointed a finger, ask them why they are the way they are. Find out. There very well could be a reason for it. And, you know, if you ever seen that movie, Lars and the Real Girl? You know what? I thought the movie was absolutely ridiculous, that person. And then I realized that this is what life is about. It's when society sits there, gathers in a circle and points a finger and stares and gossips and judges. That makes the disorder. In fact, that's the very definition of disorder. It's not the guy that has the problem. It's when society sits there and blames and points the finger and judges that guy. But when they come together, and when they sit there instead and work with that person to get through what they got through, And the outcome is something completely different from some sort of collapse of society and what we're seeing now, where we're after each other's throats.
Right. Absolutely. Yeah. And I'm a firm believer in that. You know, the more we can get people to, one, stand up for each other, you know, two, help each other out. If we start taking care of each other, whether it's, you know, giving somebody a hand up or teaching them or whatever it is, the more that we do that, the less control the government has. And obviously, they have way too much control. You know, when I need a fucking permit to grow a tomato in my front yard, kiss my balls. No, I'm not going to comply with that. But the reason they get away with this shit is, quite honestly, a lot of people have become lazy. And it makes it difficult for people in your situation because, you know, you have a valid disability. And so people are going to judge you based on what has become mainstream. You know, things are so tough, especially now, that I can assume that many people, if they thought they had a chance of getting disability, they would go do it, even if they didn't need it based on a disability, but just because the economy sucks. And so you got more and more people taking from the system. You got a guy that qualifies, that wants to put into the system, and he's knocked down. And we got to do what we can to stop that. And I mean, you're a big part of that by coming here tonight, because again, you know, this is going to touch people, and it probably won't be tomorrow or the next day, but this is going to sit there. That's the one thing I do love about the internet. You know, we can have all the sound issues and lose a listener or two because we got all these glitches or whatever, but this is going to be archived, and it's going to sit there, and it's going to sit there, and it's going to sit there, and nobody's going to make me take it down. And I don't give a shit, because if for instance, Car Arms has some leverage on Google and YouTube, and they shut down my YouTube account, well, there's another one already waiting, and I own my own website, and I will not submit. I will not. We're going to get this information out. People are going to see this, and you may not even know that it happens, but it's going to spur somebody to say, hey, that guy did it. I can do it too. And they might not even take the time to reach out to you or I for taking our time tonight, but they're just going to go off and they're going to do what you're doing, and they're going to take a bite out of the machine. And that's awesome. That's powerful.
I hope they do it bigger, and I hope they do it better, and I hope they do it in an absolute way that gets 10 times more attention. And that's absolutely, you know, the intentions of everything to do a change. You know, and that's what people need to understand, too, is, you know, being positive doesn't mean you ignore something and turn your back. Being positive means you walk through that negative in order to bring that positive change again to the next in line, even if not yourself. You know, and I know that I can't change what happened. I know that I'm not going to get out of my head some of, you know, the shit that I go with, you know, my head every single night. So help me God if I know if I can make that change, because I'm kind of in that seat. So help me God, that'll be my pride.
It's awesome that you do. I'm just going to give a time reminder, Rich. We've got about 10 minutes left, so I want you to take a minute and think if there's anything that you left out or something else that you really want to convey to everybody before you run out of time and don't get to say something that maybe you haven't said yet. So go ahead, because we've got about 10 minutes left, 9-10 minutes, I guess, and I want to make sure that you get out everything that you intended to.
Well, one thing I would like to do is, you know, thank a lot of the people that were there to give me the support, you know, like the KOP especially. You know, for anybody that doesn't know the KOP, is an activist, look them up. This guy, man, I mean, you know, I was at my worst, and he's done everything he can to help keep me afloat. He got me a job working a week. Wait, no, I didn't have the gas money to get to my hearing, you know, working for his company. You know, and this is the idea, people, where one human hand goes wrong, another one's got to make up for it somehow. And he stepped up. And without his help, you know, I wouldn't have even made it to my damn hearing. And that's the God's honest truth. So when you see somebody out there that's having that tough time, you know, don't underestimate what that little bit of help can do. You know, even if it's only 3 days of help with somebody. You know, I had that doctor, like one of my doctors gave me a free appointment with food. you know, when she knew I was having a tough time, I couldn't even feed myself, you know, and then people coming together like this and giving me all the strength in the world, it really has, you know, so I can't thank people enough for listening and taking the time, and I just hope that, you know, from what I'm seeing now in this world, the people are starting to pay attention to each other, and so it keeps growing, because we don't have the room to keep going like this anymore. You know, there's too many good souls that have been stepped on, you know, perhaps even died, all sitting there feeling all alone. You know, I heard a story of this girl, Amanda Todd. She was bullied to the point where she killed herself, you know, and then even on her death, they had people posting on the wall, you know, drink more bleach and all this shit. You know, it's sickening. Because, you know, if we can look in society and see that even the wolf, a predatory wolf, wild wolf, to welcome a human being with a video camera into that pack, let that human being be part of that pack. That tells you something, because if a human being cannot do the same with another human being, then to me, they're beneath that of even an animal. And, you know, I don't mean that disrespectful to animals. I think in my opinion, they're even more similar to humans, if not a better human than some humans. But the idea is this, if you can't do that for a fellow human being and you look for a way to find a way to hate them, then you're nothing but a predatory animal. And that's what we have to stop people, because our common enemy is all around us. And that's ego and greed. And that's what we see taken away from every single one of us. At one point in history, we've all lost something for that. Until we stand up for each other and take down that ego and greed when we see it, say something about it at least. That we're just a bunch of monkeys swinging from a tree. That's the way it is. That's what evolution means. And so we step up and step to that plate and do the right thing. We can't truly call ourselves humans.
No, we've almost become robotic. I mean, it's almost like, and there is going to be a clear division. There'll be a clear division of the people that wake up and return to some compassion and truth, and then the rest of them. But it's like we almost have presets in our mind when we come across somebody in the street. If they don't meet those presets or those filters in our mind of what someone else should be or look like or smell like or act like, then they're no good. And we automatically start attacking them, even if we don't have the balls to say it to their face. We start thinking about it in our minds, you know, and I see it all the time, and especially with the kids. I was horrified when I was in California. There was a commotion out in front of our house, and I went out to see what was going on, and there was a teenage girl on her iPhone screaming obscenities, like, and I mean, I can be foul-mouthed, don't get me wrong, but this was a young girl, worse language than I ever thought of using, right, which horrified me, but 6 feet behind her was her mother nodding her head in agreement. I had to leave the situation because I would have become violent, and we were talking about two women, which I won't go there. I had to just go back in my house at that moment. I couldn't handle that, because the only way I knew how to handle something like that was to take the iPod out of the little girl's hand and smash it, and then tell her mother what a useless whore I thought she was. I avoided that. But I still, and this was over a year ago, Rich, I'm still pissed off about it right now, because it's the mainstream now. It's how people are treating each other, you know, and I don't know. It is. That's almost a whole other show, so I won't get on a rant about that. But, I mean, I just, you know, I want to thank you personally, again, because it's people like you that give this show value. And, you know, for anybody that may be listening to this, we don't do this for money. We're here as volunteers. You know, all of the station costs are taken out of the pocket of the station owners. I mean, obviously, we're trying to work on some ways to make it pay the bills eventually. But this isn't money motivated. We're people that have decided that things need to be addressed, and we're willing to give the time to address those. So I hope anybody that has heard this tonight or sees the YouTube archive that you will share it and that you will come back to a live show and bring someone with you. That's key, that this spread, and that we start sharing this information and we start working together, and then we start giving of ourselves. Because if we can give of ourselves to take care of our neighbor, the government is going to have a lot less control over us, and I think we all want that. That's what the country stands for, right? We're supposed to be free people. We're supposed to be free people. And so, you know, let's take that back. I mean, freedom isn't a gift. You got to take it. And the only way you're going to take it is by taking care of each other, as far as I'm concerned. Rich, we've got about 2 minutes left. Any last words, any other key point that you